How's it going, Pokemon trainers? Today, we're going to do something a little bit different. We are going to start a new series specifically for brand new players to Pokemon Go, or people who are kind of casual players that may not know some of these like nitty-gritty details that are deeply embedded in the game. I know that when I first started playing, and even when I returned to the game after a little bit of a break, there were a lot of features that I just didn't understand or that I wasn't fully utilizing. So this series is going to focus on all of those things. And our first chapter, today's video, is going to cover everything there is to know about IVs in Pokemon Go. Alright, so hey trainers, welcome to or welcome back to the channel. Hopefully I'm seeing a lot of new players here. If you searched for information on Pokemon Go IVs, this brought you here, it probably means that you're a pretty new or casual player, so it's great to meet you. If you enjoy Pokemon Go and want some news, tips, tricks, and other videos like fun recaps, make sure to hit that subscribe button. My name is Megan, PokeMegan, and these are the videos that we make here on this channel. So anyway, in today's video, we are going to cover IVs in Pokemon Go. And we're kind of going to hone in on a 100% perfect IV Pokemon, or what a lot of us refer to as hundos. Now, I've received a lot of different questions. Some of you are super new players. You're asking what a hundo is, what the hundo CPs mean when we talk about those in videos. And additionally, I often get people asking me for hundo CPs on Pokemon in the wild. So since this question is a very, very common question, it made me think that maybe there's some information that isn't as readily available to casual players as it should be. Now, we're going to go through these IVs and really break them down, and we'll split this up into some sections that kind of address different questions related to IVs in Pokemon Go. So if you're only here looking for one specific thing, make sure to look down in the description where you can find the chapters listed, as well as just beneath the video on the timeline. So with that introduction, let's go ahead and get started. So now the first question I want to address is, what exactly is a hundo? So understanding the IVs of a Pokemon means you really need to understand their purpose, and the ultimate goal when looking at IVs of a Pokemon in Pokemon Go is to hopefully find one that has very good IVs, with the maximum being 100%. This is what we refer to as a hundo in the game. And this essentially means it is the strongest that that particular Pokemon has the potential to be. And now, for any of you who are new or casual player to the game, let's really break down what IVs are in Pokemon Go. So IV stands for individual value, and this is a value assigned to Pokemon, and this has happened across all of the games in the franchise. And in the later series games, usually what will happen is once you get to a certain level in the game, you're able to look at a Pokemon's IVs. Now, typically in some of the past games, the IVs have a breakdown that's pretty complicated. I'll use Sword and Shield for an example, the most recent game that has come out. Once you are able to unlock the feature that allows you to look at IVs, they're classified by words like best, good, fantastic, I think is the top one. But essentially what these refer to in the game are statistics for your Pokemon. Now, in every single Pokemon game, including Pokemon Go, IVs are stats that cannot be changed. They come imprinted on your Pokemon, and in Pokemon Go, there is nothing you can do to change them. Technically, there are a few things you can do to sort of change the IVs of Pokemon, but we'll cover that later. Right now, I just want you to understand that these stats realistically cannot be changed on an individual Pokemon. So this stat is a little bit different than the CP or combat power, which you see above the Pokemon's bar right here. So that CP can be changed. Every single Pokemon has a CP spread from the lowest to the highest CP that they can be, and these go up as the Pokemon levels up. So simply by giving a Pokemon candy and leveling it up, you're going to see that CP get higher. So make sure not to confuse the CP, which can be altered, versus the IVs, which cannot be. So now that you know exactly what IVs are on a Pokemon, how do we find that information in Pokemon Go? When I first started playing Pokemon Go, when it first came out, I didn't even know this feature existed, I didn't know how to use it, and I never used it, so I never knew exactly how strong my Pokemon were. When I finally discovered that this appraisal system was available to check IVs of Pokemon way later in the game, I went through some of the Pokemon that I had saved as my best Pokemon simply because their CPs were high. It turns out most of those Pokemon actually weren't that great because they had really low IVs. So if this is your first time hearing about or even considering IVs, make sure to note that down, that saving Pokemon that have high CPs is not necessarily a good way to go. It's more important to consider their IVs when you're deciding which Pokemon to keep or get rid of. Now, a bit of Pokemon Go history. When this game first came out, the appraisal system, which allows you to check how strong your Pokemon's IVs were, was very ambiguous, and your team leader would come out and essentially say phrases such as, overall, your Pokemon is really strong. Now, each of those phrases would correspond to a different percentage spread for IVs. So it was kind of a little bit of guesswork, and you also had to pretty much Google what all these different different phrases mean or to really understand what you were getting out of them. But that has since changed, and now in Pokemon Go, we have one of the simplest ways to appraise your Pokemon. So to do this, all you have to do is pick any Pokemon in your storage, click on them, open up their profile page, click that little hamburger icon right down in the bottom right-hand corner, and then click the appraise button from this list. Once you do that, your team leader is going to pop up and ask you if you want to appraise your Pokemon. Click in one more time, and then you're going to see this little graphic pop up. Okay, so now that we have this little appraisal graphic up, what exactly does this mean? So like I said, in Pokemon Go, it's a lot simpler than most of the other games in the franchise. Normally in Pokemon games, you're gonna have 5 different stats. In Pokemon, we only have 3. So here you can see that there's attack, defense, and HP. Now in other games, we also have a special attack, a special defense, and a speed stat. But anyway, these 3 stats do make a lot more sense specifically for Pokemon Go, because we don't really have a special attack or a special defense like most of the other Pokemon games. In Pokemon Go, we just have general attacks, general defense numbers. So now, how exactly do we calculate these IVs with this appraisal graphic that we get from our team leader? So essentially, these bars are going to show you what your Pokemon's IV percentages from 0% all the way up to 100. Now, as you can see, it doesn't give you specific numbers in game for this, so it takes a little bit of math work, some visualization work, and some memorization of how these all work. But one thing that's really, really easy to notice is if all 3 of those bars are completely empty, or if all 3 of those bars are completely full. So when you have literally none of these bars, there's no orange whatsoever, they're completely empty, this means your Pokemon is 0% IVs. So that means every single one of these stats is a 0. Now, each one of these stats can range anywhere from 0 to 15, totaling in 45 points on your IVs. Now look at this graphic and see how each bar is split into 3. Now because the total IV point for each bar is 15, that means that each section is 5 points. So when you look at it visually, that should give you an idea of how you could calculate that just by looking at it. So now, we talked about 0% Nundos. On the flip side, if these bars are filled all the way to the top, that means your Pokemon is 100% IV. It's perfect. It is the best IV stats that Pokemon could possibly have. And also your graphic is going to change, the bars are going to be red, and then right above it, those stars are going to fill in and the circles are going to become pink. So that's like a little dopamine hit when you get that 100% IV and you get to see that graphic change colors. So it's worth mentioning that 0% IV Pokemon, or Nundos, are the rarest IV spread that you can find in the game. Now, technically speaking, every single IV percentage from 0 to 100 should all have an equal chance of being the IV spread on your Pokemon. No matter how many different combos you make, you have an equal chance of getting every single percentage. However, with the introduction of shadow Pokemon into the game, you may or may not know that purifying a shadow Pokemon increases your Pokemon's IVs by 2 points on every single bar. So that means even if you find a Pokemon with IVs as low as 13, 13, 13, purifying them will make them a hundo. This in turn makes getting a hundo a little bit higher odds than getting a Nundo, because you cannot manipulate the IV stats to make a Pokemon change to 0% IVs the way that you can manipulate it to change to 100% IVs. So on either side of this coin, just to note, a 0% IV Pokemon or a 100% IV Pokemon are extremely rare in game. The Nundos are kind of just more of a collector's item because they're essentially not going to be that great in battle. And then Hundo Pokemon, especially if you're catching them in the wild without any in-game condition changes or any Pokemon status changes, the chances of finding a Hundo Pokemon in the wild are 1 in 4,096. So these are rare Pokemon. And once you find those, you should definitely put candy and stardust into powering those Pokemon up. Use your TMs to make sure they have the best type attacks. Especially if they're a very strong Pokemon on their own, like a legendary dragon type, a great ice, other normal type attackers like Mamoswine, Garchomp, Rhyperior, any of those really, really good battle Pokemon, finding a hundo of those is awesome. Now, next up, there are status conditions in the game that do affect a Pokemon's ability to have stronger IVs. So like we sort of mentioned earlier, just a Pokemon out in the wild with no weather boost is always going to have the potential to be anywhere from 0% IVs all the way up to 100. Now this changes if there is a weather boost on Pokemon out in the wild. It also changes if you encounter Pokemon in other parts of the game. This includes research rewards, raiding, and even training with a friend. Now I want to bring this up because if you watch any Pokemon content creators, particularly Pokemon Go out there, you have probably heard a lot of these content creators refer to Hundo CPs. Now, if you're a new player or you're not super familiar with this term, it could be a little confusing because essentially what we're telling you is to look out for one specific combat power number which can alert you that your Pokemon is a Hundo IV. Now, this is where I think a lot of people are confused off the bat, and I often get a lot of people asking me, what is the Hundo CP for wild Pokemon? I see this often like during Spotlight Hour where people ask, well, what's the Hundo IV for the Pokemon during the Spotlight Hour? And the short answer is that there is no one specific Hundo IV for wild Pokemon. So how come Pokemon in the wild do not have Hundo CPs the way that research Pokemon and raid Pokemon do? Essentially, it's because Pokemon in the wild can be any level. And when it comes down to it, a Pokemon spawn or Pokemon encounter before you catch it is always going to be one specific level. And for the specific level that it is, the Pokemon it is, the IV spread as it corresponds to the level and the combat power is going to be different for every single Pokemon. Now, the difference is that in research encounters, egg hatches, and raid battles, Pokemon only come in one level. So there is always going to be only one CP value that corresponds to a Hundo Perfect IV for that Pokemon. Hopefully this makes sense. We're going to break this down a little bit more. So one website that I use very, very often to learn these different Hundo CPs across levels and Pokemon types is GoHub. So we're going to pull up GoHub right now for you and show you how to use this tool if you're ever curious about looking up specific combat power numbers that equate to the Pokemon having 100% IVs. So let's go ahead and choose Dugtrio here because that is my favorite Pokemon. All you have to do is click into the IV page here on GoHub, and then this bar just down below it, you can select the level of the Pokemon. So let's start with a research encounter. So research encounters are always going to be level 15. Research encounters cannot be affected by weather, so any Pokemon you get in research is always going to be level 15, even if it is a Pokemon that ordinarily would be weather boosted at that time. So let's say you have a fire type Pokemon as your research encounter, and it's sunny out. Now, all of your wild fire type Pokemon will have a weather boost, which is going to make their level higher, which means that their combat power and IV spreads can change, but this isn't going to happen in a research encounter. So here we have this level 15 page for Dugtrio pulled up, and now you can see here these stats show you every single CP level and IV percentage for each Pokemon. So hopefully this gives you a better idea of how these numbers are all connected. So right up here at the top for a level 15 Dugtrio, the 100% IVs are the 15, 15, 15 spread. That means that each stat, attack, defense, and HP are all maxed out at 15 points. The CP on that Pokemon is always going to be 667. So this really is the only number you need to know if you are specifically hunting a Pokemon from research encounters looking for the Hundo. Now, you can do this with any Pokemon that is available in the game right now. Let's also do one for raids. So in raids, there are going to be two different levels of Pokemon. So you're either going to have non-weather boosted or weather boosted. Those are the only two things that are going to affect raid bosses. So with no weather boost, the Pokemon is always going to be level 20, and then with a weather boost, it's going to be boosted up to level 25. Now there are going to be visual cues on the screen as well as text that pops up when you're in a raid battle telling you that a Pokemon is boosted by weather. There's also usually an icon, so it's really easy to determine whether or not the Pokemon you're facing is boosted by weather. This comes in really handy as well if you're remote raiding because you can't actually see the weather that's happening in the location where you are remote raiding. So let's go ahead and try this again. Let's pull up Rayquaza because that's one of the best legendaries. So here we are, and now let's just go ahead and set this top bar to level 20. And as you can see right here at the top is the 15, 15, 15, 100% IV on Rayquaza at level 20. So again, these stats correspond to a non-weather boosted Rayquaza raid. So if you see a Rayquaza with 2191 CP, once you encounter that after the raid, that means you have a Hundo. On the flip side, if it's weather boosted, it's going to be level 20. And that CP is going to be 2739. So if you ever watch streamers or watch anyone live or watch videos where people encounter a Pokemon and you see it there on the screen before catching it and people already know that it's a Hundo, this is how they are doing it. Just by memorizing those two specific numbers for either boosted or non-boosted. And this just makes it a little bit more exciting because you can determine the second you encounter the Pokemon if it has good or bad IVs. So now let's return back to wild Pokemon. There's really no point in and trying to look at the CPs of wild spawns to determine whether or not your Pokemon is going to be low or high IVs, because we don't know the specific level of the Pokemon upon its encounter. One CP number that's a hundo for one level of a Pokemon is not going to be the CP number for a different level of that same Pokemon. So let's jump really quickly back into Dugtrio and let's explore some of these different levels of this Pokemon so that I can kind of show you through the numbers that there's so many different numerical options to look at. So it can get very confusing because one number that might be a terrible IV spread on, let's say, a level 10 Pokemon could also be the same number that is actually the hundo CP on a different level Pokemon. So now here you go on this Dugtrio looking at level 11 Pokemon, you'll see the hundo CP up here for specifically level 11 Pokemon in the wild. Now let's just flip to another number and you can see how every single number is different. So since you can't ever tell really what level the Pokemon is on an encounter, it's nearly impossible to take any information from the CP of a wild Pokemon, other than simply knowing that it's probably a high level if it has high CP. Okay, now we're going to get into the very nitty-gritty mathematical aspect to understanding Pokemon Go IV spreads. I find this to be a bit complicated. I'm not super good at simple math or just numbers in general. I know that there are some trainers out there who could simply look down at the photo of the appraisal graphic showing IVs and just know right off the top of their head exactly what percentage IV that is. And there are ways to do this. There are little tricks you can memorize to figure out how to look at this visually and determine if it's a 98. Some people can go all the way as far down as like 70%, any number in there. I, for one, just tend to use an app. We'll talk about those apps a little bit later as well. So earlier in the video, we addressed that each one of these bars has a maximum of 15 points. So 0 to 15 on each individual of the three bars, giving us a total of 45 IV points. So I'm going to go ahead and just pull up a Pokemon from my storage so that we can look at this here. Okay, so we're doing our appraisal, and here you can see on this visual bar, we have on the defense that is full, it is red, that means it is full 15 points. And as you can see, the attack and the HP aren't full. So now essentially how you wanna look at this is that every single tick in here, now remember there's 15 ticks in every single one of these bars. Now, every single tick that it drops is going to equate to roughly 2% IV. Now bear with me, I know this is very confusing, but hopefully I can talk you through this to make sense of it. So it does take a little bit of practice to be able to visually look and determine exactly how many ticks are missing. So on this Groudon, both the attack and HP have 2 ticks missing. So visually that looks about halfway down, which is kind of deceptive because there are 5 ticks in here. So technically 2 ticks away shouldn't put it at the halfway mark, but I digress. So in total, there are 4 total ticks drop down, 2 off of attack and 2 off of HP. So now because these typically correspond with 2% of IV points, you should be able to determine that this is minus 8% IVs. Now again, it's not always 2. So as you can see here, I use an app to give my Groudon its IV percentage, which is 91. So when you're missing 4 total ticks, that is going to make your Pokemon a 91% IV. So it ends up being 9 percentage points. And this also just takes a little bit of memorization to memorize every different tier as you drop down when you're missing a tick. Hopefully I explained that well enough for you. Let's go ahead and pull up another Pokemon here. Let me see if I have, this might be me flexing my legendary Pokemon, even though most of them are crap. So here is a 96% Rayquaza. Now that's really, really easy to appraise your Pokemon and visually figure out the IVs when it's this high. So this one's almost identical to the Groudon we just looked at. So you can see the defense is also completely full. That's 15 on the defense. And then our attack and our HP, these are only missing 1 tick. So if you look back and forth what the Rayquaza visual looks like versus the Groudon that we just looked at, you can tell the difference in visualization from 1 tick versus 2 ticks. So here there's 1 missing from the top and 1 missing from the bottom. So that means minus 2% from the attack and minus 2% for the HP, which makes our Pokemon 96% IVs. That's 100 minus 4, 96% IVs. So now as you can see, these 2 ticks do correspond to 2%. Again, there's a bit of memorization you have to do to determine exactly how many ticks taken off the total IVs corresponds to which percentage, but roughly it's 2% on every tick. So just to keep seeing how this looks visually, here we have a Rayquaza that's got a full 15 on defense and HP, but but then on our attack, we are missing 3 ticks on this. So now remember before when we were missing 4 ticks off of Groudon, that put us at a 91%. Here, you can see that that top bar is missing 3 ticks, which normally would mean 6%, but again, this is another one that drops down, and its total for these 3 ticks is actually 7%. Now again, looking at this top bar, it looks like that little bit there in that third sector on this bar, that's 2 ticks. So you can see why this can be a little complicated. Okay, here we go. So on this Zapdos, you can see what the 1 tick looks like. So on the attack there, that little orange piece that comes into that third section on attack, that's 1 tick. So hopefully that should help you understand the size visually of what 1 tick is. Okay. Let's close out of that and continue talking about this a little bit more. So like I said earlier, if you're someone who's really quick with math, really good at just doing math in your head and being able to kind of memorize what these things look like visually, you could potentially determine the percentage IV of your Pokemon every single time just by pulling up this appraisal bar. Now for those of us who aren't good at math, like me, there are lots of apps out there that can also help you with this and do all of the math and figure out all the stats of your Pokemon just with the click of a button. So my favorite app to use for this is PokeGenie. Now, I'm not in any way affiliated with PokeGenie. I'm not like trying to sell you anything here. It's a completely free app, at least as far as I use it, which is typically just to tell me all of the stats of my Pokemon. So I'm gonna go ahead and pull this up. So this is the PokeGenie app, and as you can see, there's a lot of different functions in here. I typically don't use a lot of these functions, although they are very, very useful. There's a place that you can look for remote raids in here as well, so if you're someone who doesn't have a lot of friends to raid with, this app is also really good for that. However, what we're going to do is start this overlay down here at the bottom. So what's gonna happen is I'm gonna push this start overlay button, and then you're gonna see that little logo pop up there in front of my Pokemon screen. So we still have our Zapdos here that we just looked at a little while ago. I've got the appraisal pulled up. Now all I have to do is tap on that icon and then it will pop up these stats. So here you can see it is showing me that the Zapdos is at 87% IVs, which is technically great IVs. Some of you out there might have higher standards. Maybe you only consider 100% even worth keeping. So as you can see, it shows me that my attack is 11 and defense and HP are at 14. And there's a few other stats in here that are super useful as well. It also calculates the Go Battle League PvP IV spreads for you. So you can see that this Zapdos is only 59.2% in the Ultra League. Now, I don't do Go Battle League, but for any of you out there that do and aren't using this app, I definitely recommend it because as you may or may not know, the IV spreads for Great and Ultra League are very, very different than what you would expect to just have a Pokemon for battle. So a 100% IV Pokemon isn't going to be as strong in Great and Ultra League as it would just battling in like other raids and stuff. So for GBL, there's a whole different set of IV spreads that you want to look out for your strongest Pokemon. This app can help you with that as well if you don't want to memorize different spread numbers. So anyway, lastly, this also tells you the exact CP of the Pokemon, which you can see that pretty easily anyway. It also tells you the level of the Pokemon, which is also super convenient to have. Now, as you can see here, the Zapdos is level 20. I caught it from a raid in non-boosted weather, so it came as level 20 and I haven't put any energy into powering this particular Zapdos up. Now, the way that this app figures out the level of the Pokemon, if you look up here just above Zapdos's wing there, you'll see a plus sign on that CP bar. So where that fills up on a Pokemon is always going to correspond with a specific level. So this app is able to visually look at how far that bar is up and determine the level of your Pokemon. So kind of a hidden stat that you can figure out from this app as well. Okay, and then next up, finally, we're going to address how to change the IVs of Pokemon in Pokemon Go. Now, I know at the beginning of the video, I specified that IV stats of a Pokemon cannot be changed. We did cover these shadow Pokemon. I'll repeat myself quickly again for anyone who's using the chapters, but there are only 2 ways to technically change the IV stats of any Pokemon you have, the first one being purifying a shadow Pokemon. So if you have a shadow Pokemon and you purify it, its IV stats are going to go up by 2 points on every single bar. So again, if you have a 13-13-13 shadow Pokemon and you purify it, it's going to become a Hundo purified Pokemon. Now, pro tip, I'm going to recommend that you do not purify your shadow Pokemon unless it's kind of a pointless Pokemon that's never going to be very good in battle, GBL, anywhere, and you just want the Hundo for your collection. But if you have something like a shadow Mewtwo, a shadow legendary, a very, very strong strong Pokemon in its shadow form, even if it can become a hundo by purification. Don't purify it, because those shadow Pokemon get a shadow Pokemon boost, so essentially a Nundo shadow Pokemon is still going to be stronger than a hundo non-shadow Pokemon. I know that sounds crazy, but it's just how the shadow bonus works. So that technically is really the only way to change the IVs of an actual Pokemon. However, trading Pokemon also re-rolls their IV spreads. So what that means is when you trade away a Pokemon, it is not going to keep its IV spreads. The dice are going to get rolled again on that Pokemon, and that Pokemon can be anywhere from 0% to 100% at its very most basic level. Now, this is also where trading gets a little bit complicated as far as numbers go. So now, if you add someone on Pokemon Go and do not level up your friendship, the first friendship level up to good friend, all you have to do is have one interaction with them. So if for any reason you add someone on Pokemon Go and immediately trade with them before having any interaction, and you're not even good friends, then your IV spread can be anywhere from 0 to 100%. So this is pointless. Don't do it. It also costs a ton of Stardust. Unless you're really just doing it to get a Pokemon that you don't have, that's fine. But as far as IVs go, if you're looking for a high IV Pokemon, don't trade this way. So now, every single time you move up in a friendship tier, the IV spread for that Pokemon is going to decrease. This means that there's an IV floor, which means there's a specific percentage that's as low as the Pokemon can possibly go. Hopefully that makes sense. If not, drop some comments. I'll try to help you out. So on this tier, if you make a trade with a good friend, your IV floor for each stat is going to be 1. So that means you cannot get a Nundo. You cannot get a 0%. The lowest that every single one of those bars can go is 1 tick. 1 on attack, 1 on defense, and 1 on HP. Now for great friends, that is going to bump up to 2. So the lowest you can get is a 2-2-2. For ultra friends, it jumps up to 3. And for best friends, that jumps up to 5. So if you have a local best friend that you can trade with very often, that's kind of a sweet deal, because if you're just like trading whatever Pokemon you want, just getting extra candy or trying to get lucky friends, you're never gonna get a Nundo. That Pokemon at its very lowest is going to be 5-5-5. So that gives you a little bit higher of a chance to actually get a hundo. There's less numbers that can happen when you re-roll the IV dice on it. So it's kind of a good way to technically hundo hunt if you just trade rapid fire, hoping to get good IVs on a Pokemon. And then finally, the ultimate trade that you could possibly have between friends is a lucky trade. Now, lucky trades have an IV floor of 12. This means the lowest possible IV spread you can get from a lucky trade is 12, 12, 12. Now, as far as it goes for most Pokemon, especially wild Pokemon, a 12, 12, 12 is pretty decent considering how much lower it could have been. So lucky trades are always the best way to go. Now, there are two different ways to get lucky trades. The first one is completely random. Any trade has the potential to become a lucky trade, and it usually has about a 5% chance of happening, or a 1 in 20. Now, this doesn't mean you're guaranteed a lucky trade every 1 in 20 trades. I think I've gone like almost 100 trades before without getting a lucky trade. So just like shiny odds, lucky trade odds can work in your favor or sometimes not in your favor. The second way to get a lucky trade is to become lucky friends with a trainer. So once you are best friends with another trainer, every single time you have any interaction with them, that includes opening a gift, raiding with them, battling with them, any of the ways to get a daily interaction with another trainer, you have a chance to become lucky friends. Now, I don't know the exact percent chance on this one, but it's not crazy common, nor is it crazy rare. If you're interacting with your best friends every single day, you're pretty regularly going to hit lucky friends with those best friends. So if you're not familiar with being a lucky friend, what that means is once you become lucky friends, the next trade that you make together is guaranteed to be lucky. So just a side note, you want to save this interaction pretty much for like shiny legendaries or super rare shinies. And I always recommend that you do like a mirror trade. So let's say you have a shiny legendary and the IVs are crap. They're like the lowest they can go for a legendary Pokemon, and you would like to get a shiny legendary that has better IVs. What you want to do is wait for a lucky friend and then mirror trade that Pokemon with that friend. What that means is they are going to trade you the exact same Pokemon. So you have a shiny Dialga, you want them to also trade you a shiny Dialga. So let's say from a legendary raid, you get a Dialga that's 10, 10, 10, which is the lowest a legendary raid could be. You know that that trade is going to net you a better shiny Dialga because the floor for that trade is going to be 12, 12, 12. So doing a lucky trade like this is the highest percent chance of getting hundo IVs because you only have from 12 215 on each one of those bars. So that exponentially increases your chance to get a Shundo or a Hundo IV Pokemon. That's why I recommend doing shiny legendaries for lucky traits. Essentially, those numbers are about a 1 in 64 chance. All right, trainers, I know that was a long one. It was a bit confusing. Hopefully I articulated it well enough for you to understand how the different IVs work in Pokemon Go. For such a simple, fun game, there are a lot of complicated aspects to it. That being said, if you found this helpful, if you enjoyed, make sure to drop a sub, a like, a comment, whatever you feel like. And if you are a new player or a casual player who wants more of these kind of down to the basics explanations for Pokemon Go, this is the first video in the series, but once there are more, I will create a playlist and I will put that link right up at the top for you as well as in the description. So make sure to check that playlist out as well. Okay, well that's gonna do it for this one and hopefully I'll see you all soon in the next video. Have an awesome day!